So now I'm going to jump right in and start talking about public goods. So remember, public goods are both non-rival and non-excludable. So they're non-rival, so whatever quantity we provide for one person, we don't diminish the quality of the good by letting more people enjoy it. And since they're non-excludable, if we provide it once, we provide it collectively for everyone. So I'm going to have an example here, and I'm going to think about five different people living on a street, and they don't have any street lights right now, but they're going to think about having some street lights. And I've put down their incremental or marginal willingness to pay, or marginal benefit, from the number of street lights that they have. So person A is the person who values the street lights the most. Maybe they're elderly, and they, you know, have bad eyesight, and they are afraid of stumbling in the dark. Maybe they're someone who just has a fear of the dark. Maybe they're someone who has a lot of valuable stuff, so it's particularly valuable to them to deter thievery by having the area well lit. It doesn't really matter. So what we're going to see here is that this person values the first street light at $15, values the second street light at $12, values the third street light at $9, and so on and so forth down here. And I'm going to have two people who value the street light a little bit less, street lights a little bit less. They value the first one at $9, the second one at $7, third one at $5, and so on and so forth. And finally, two more people who value the street light even less. And so their willingness to pay is 3, 2, 1, 0, 0. Okay. Now, if we just let people think about how many street lights they want, and they think about it in a fairly straightforward manner, and they don't sort of think strategically about trying to sort of outsmart everyone else, what we would see is that person A would go, you know what, the first street light, that's worth it for me, if it has something like a marginal cost of $10. And the second street light, yeah, that's worth it to me too. So they want to have two street lights, and then that's it. The third street light is not worth enough for them to want to have it be provided. People B and C are not willing to pay, at least independently, for any street lights, and definitely not people D and E if they have this marginal cost of $10 per street light. So, in the absence of some sort of coordinating plan, if we just looked at what we might call a market equilibrium here, we're going to see that the quantity is going to be 2. Then the question arises, what's the efficient quantity? And to figure out the efficient quantity, we need to figure out what the total willingness to pay for the first street light is, and the second street light, and so on and so forth. So the total willingness to pay for the first street light is $15 plus 2 times $9, because we have two people who value it at $9, plus 2 times $3, and that gets us up to $39 of value for that street light. We do something similar for the second street light. One person values it at $12, plus two people at $7, plus two people at $2 each. And if we add all those up, we get to 30. And same kind of thing going down the line here. Okay, so we have now the overall estimate of the total social value to everyone combined. And we can see that, you know, if you can get this thing provided for a cost of $10, and the combined value that everyone places on it at 30 is $39, then that's a no-brainer. Obviously, we're better off by getting that first one provided, and the second one, and the third one, and finally, this fourth one is the last one we want to buy, because it's the last one that has a total willingness to pay greater than its marginal cost of $10. So the logical idea then presumably would be, let's go ahead and get 4 street lights. That'll cost $40, so 4 street lights, $10 each, that costs us $40. And let's go ahead and fund that through some kind of tax. And let's start with the simple case that we're going to have a tax that's equal. We have five people living on the street, and so $40 divided by five people is $8 of tax each. So let's think about how that affects people's economic welfare. Well, persons D and E, the combined benefit they get is $6. And we're putting $8 of tax on them. So overall, when we take both the streetlights and the tax into account, they're paying $10 and getting $8 of services as they assess the value in return. So this actually makes them worse off. These people are what we call forced riders. Forced riders, which is the opposite of what we had before. Before, we had free riders. If person two demands two stoplights, then persons B and C get $16 worth of benefits and don't have to pay anything. They're getting a free ride, hitching a ride on person A's expenditure. And persons D and E got $5 of benefits without putting any contribution in, so they were also free riding. So if we have private provision, we're going to have an under efficient quantity and free riding. If we have public provision, we may have the efficient quantity, but we may end up having some forced riders here. And notice it's the people who value the good relatively little who are going to be the forced riders here. These other groups of people are going to be net beneficiaries of this. So 16, 21, 24, each of these people gets $24 worth of benefit, pays $8 worth of tax, so gets net benefit of plus 16. And then person A, 15, 27, 36, 42. If I'm doing my math right, this person gets 42 minus 8, gets us $34 of net benefits. So that's one thing that might happen when we have public good provision. We might decide that we don't want the market allocation, but instead want to sort of get together and vote and tax ourselves and provide these things communally. Both of them have potential problems associated with them. In a second, I'll go ahead and explore, well, do we want to fund this by that kind of everybody pays an equal amount of tax mechanism?